Hope all speakers have come now. Hello.
We are checking on it,
sir. Sehgal, sir, some issue, sir, network issue. Within a few minutes, he'll join, sir.
Okay.
Yes. Hi, Ankan. Good evening.
Hello, ma'am. Good evening. How are you?
Yeah, fine. Thank you.
Sundaram Pillai is there.
Namaste, sir. Sundaram, sir.
Ravindran is there. Ravindran.
Ravindran, sir. Ramendra, sir. Good evening.
Ma'am, we can't see you, though. I mean, it's completely black.
Jitender Bhargav has logged in. Hello, good evening, Jitender.
Jitender, good evening.
Good evening, sir. Jitendra, sir.
Ravi, hi.
Indran,
hi.
JP, hi. Hi. Hi, Gita.
Hi.
Hello. Good evening. Good evening,
sir. Panda, sir. Good evening, sir.
Yeah, good evening.
Where's Panda? Oh. Hello, Panda ji.
Yeah, good evening.
Jai Jagannath, Dr. Panda.
Namaskar. Ravindra, hello. How are you, Ravindra?
Jai Jagannath. I'm fine.
Jai Jagannath.
Panda sahab, namaskar.
Namaskar.
JP here.
Yeah,
right.
Many from all the zones. Perhaps we may not be knowing each other, but I see a lot of people.
Sir, Jairam, sir.
Yeah.
Our chief guest logged in, sir. Kumar Pushkar.
Okay. Yeah, welcome, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Welcome, Pushkar, sir.
Good evening, and thanks for letting me join this. So nice of you.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Good evening, Lata.
Sir, good evening, sir. Namaste.
And wish you all the best for the success of this webinar.
Thank you so much, sir. Thanks a lot, sir.
Already
86 are there. Good evening. Ram from PRCI Kerala.
Yeah. Let them introduce themselves. Otherwise, it is very difficult for us to identify people. Yeah.
I think we can start, right, Jairam?
Yes, ma'am. We'll
you ask Lata. I don't know. She has to tell.
I think we should start. We have 8 people.
1 minute, ma'am. Sehgal sir is going to this and join. And another 1 minute.
Yeah, that's why I said she.
Yeah.
He knows who is who. There, you know, speakers. Let her say yes. Before that, I would like to share a few things. I'm happy to inform you that our long-awaited book, you know. From publication wing, edited by none other than our Mr. S. Narendra, former advisor to the 4 prime ministers. He is going to bring the book, Communication Perspective, the first publication of PRCI of this year, is going to be released October 1st week. We will announce everything. Digital team and publicity are at it. They will come back to you with all details soon. And other issue is Director Mr. Ravi for the other group. They're also coming out with a very big crash course, you know, on public relations. The theme and everything they will be announcing. I think Pallavi can give some details now if she is there. Pallavi?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Please tell now before they start the comments of this.
So we
need all the support from everyone. We need support from everyone.
Yes, sir. Basically, the whole objective of this initiative of PRCI, which is a very independent cell of PRCI, is to redefine education. And I think the founder, Jairam sirs, and the Vinay sir, and everyone's, Geeta ma'ams, their whole, this idea has been a superb initiative, because this is going to really help PRCI take, help us to take PRCI to a very global level. Because we, our objective and our vision is to make it to this level of how do we take communication to a very global level, and how do we really redefine education and bring it up, ensure that we are focused towards skill development. And of course, one of our objectives at of YCC has always been to make students and the next generation employable and ready for the industries. So this initiative will help us drive things in that direction. And we will surely, it's a baby right now, which is still a fetus. And so we would need everyone's support. And we are right now in the conceptualization phase. So we have to come out with the dates and the whole concrete approach to the concept and all of that. But then we will need ideas, support from all corners of the world to make it happen and to take it to a global level. Thank you so much to all. And thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Nikhil will start.
Sure, ma'am. We can start.
Yeah. Later, Sehgal sir will join. Okay.
Okay, sure. We'll go with the flow, ma'am. All right. Once again, good evening, everybody. This is your host, moderator for this evening. My name is Nikhil, and I have to welcome all of you to this international webinar on World Tourism Day 2020. In fact, organized by PRCI Bangalore chapter. First of all, I'd request all of you to kindly keep your microphones on mute at all times so that it ensures that we have a smooth webinar for this evening. It's a sincere request from our end. Kindly don't unmute your microphones. Keep it on mute. So thank you so much for that one. All right. So the theme for today, today's international webinar, is a travel talk on tomorrow's destination, because, of course, it's World Tourism Day today. And also, I might just quickly add, it's also Daughter's Day today. So, you know, we are celebrating, PRCI is celebrating two occasions. Same day, but primarily we're looking at World Tourism Day 2020. All right. In fact, quick insight into this webinar. We'll have all the dignitaries talk first. We'll talk about PRCI. We'll talk about YCC, WCC very quickly. And then we're going to move on to the esteemed speakers from across the globe. We have people from across the globe. We have from Singapore. We have from Nepal. Of course, we have from India as well. And they're going to talk about their topic for a maximum time limit of 10 minutes each. That's going to include question and answers, because we are hard pressed on time with regards to these online webinars. So I kindly request all the esteemed guest speakers have a time limit of 10 minutes each. And also, audience, please note, kindly post your question to the respective speakers addressed to their names on the chat box only. Please do not unmute your microphones to ask the questions. I request the audience to post your questions to the respective speakers along with their name. This is going to happen right after each speaker has finished their talk. So we're not going to wait till the very end for all the questions to come in. So kindly note, audience, you can post your questions to the designated speakers along with their names right after their talk is over. So I will guide you through that as well. All right. But before I invite Dr. Lata to speak, I have to, in fact, 2020 is not a great year so far. We have seen a lot of events, a lot of incidents that should not have happened, right, from COVID-19. We've come to 2020, but COVID-19 is still, you know, having its havoc on humanity, I can say, across the world. And of course, I have to request everybody, let's do a 1 minute silence and pay our condolences before we start to the departed souls. That's Mr. Jayant, the Governing Council, National Director, PRCI. Also, we have Mrs. Rupa, PRCI member, KPTCL, and Mr. Arvind Kumar, Executive Director, Ad Club. We lost these noble souls. So can we have 1 minute of silence, please, ladies and gentlemen? Condolences to these departed souls. Thank you so much. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We pay our homage and condolences to the departed souls. All right, a quick announcement as well. We are live on Facebook as well. So if you're unable to log into the Zoom platform, I request people to log into the Facebook as well, PRCI official page, so that you can watch this webinar and participate in the webinar as well. All right, so moving on, I would like to invite Dr. Latha T.S., who's the chairperson, PRCI Bangalore, to speak about World Tourism Day, the international webinar. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, Nikhil. Warm good evening to everyone. Greetings of the World Tourism Day. Rebuilding tourism in a safe, reliable, people-friendly way is the need of the hour. Unquestionably, the COVID-19 pandemic is one of the most impactful events of the 21st century and has tremendous effects on tourism. When the entire world is breaking the cocoon to explore the world, we earnestly extend our support to unlatch the lock through an international webinar. Public Relations Council of India believes in taking up subjects for deliberation which is related to societal needs. The tourism sector has been one of the hardest hit vertical by COVID-19 pandemic. Therefore, we decided to dwell on this subject for talk. Since 1980, United Nations have been observing World Tourism Day. The aim of the day is to awareness about the role of tourism and to focus on the fact that traveling as a major social, cultural, political, and economic effect on our lives. As we all know, the economic contribution of tourism sector is enormous. It employs 1 in every 10 people and provides livelihoods to millions. For some countries, it can represent over 20% of their GDP. Restrictions on travel and a sudden drop in tourists have led to an unprecedented fall, resulting in economic downfall and huge employment loss. Tourism can eventually help us to move beyond the pandemic by bringing people together and promoting solidarity, trust, and confidence. As stated by great personality, His Holiness the Dalai Lama, once a year, go somewhere you have never been before. The heart of tourist is a voracious one, as no matter how many places one visits, the urge to explore newer terrains just never diminishes. People have been traveling to landscape both known and unknown since time immortal. The desire to explore new places and cultures has helped the world to come together and connect effectively. When the travel industry is facing a soul-searching moment, PRCI has roped in to connect people according to their need, necessity, and importance to rethink and rebuild the future of the tourism sector. Now the world is reopening. We hope this webinar will bring an opportunity to design tomorrow's travel by discussing the topic related to ecotourism, digital tourism, religious and spiritual tourism, travel PR and communication, and the global perspective shaping the tourism of tomorrow. The COVID-19 crisis led to a change in travel decision, destination, behavior, and travel pattern. With all odds, travel always regarded as the healthiest addiction to dream, discover, and explore. Now, let us zoom around the world with our eminent travel personalities. Thank you, Andanal. Over to Nikhil. Thank you.
Thank you so much, madam. And indeed, the world is reopening as well post the COVID pandemic. Now, let's welcome Dr. Vinay Kumar, who is the National President, PRCI, to welcome all of us. Over to you, sir.
Hello, good evening, everyone. We are having a webinar organized by the Bangalore chapter on this World Tourism Day. In fact, tourism and travel, these two industries are the worst hit because of this pandemic. It's actually, the world is actually opening up. I had the opportunity to participate in the first event in Cochin recently, organized by EMA, Event and Entertainment Management Association, and EMAC, Event Management Association of Kerala, an event organized at Le Meridien with the support of the hotel. So I was lucky to take part in that. So slowly, slowly, it is opening up. So let us hope and pray that everything will be all right within no time. At this juncture, I would like to welcome all the speakers and also our Chairman Emeritus and Chief Mentor, MB Jayaram, our Vice Senior Vice President, K. Ravindran and our zone chairman, South Zone chairman, Jayaprakash Rao, and all the dignitaries from various chapters like Ramendra Kumar from Lower Kaila, and all other people, Sahu, I mean, our Jitendra Bhargava sir, the former executive director of Air India, and our director, Dr. Lata, our chairman, Bangalore chapter, Ashish Tayal, chairman, Nagpur chapter, and all others. I'm not naming. If I left out anyone, please excuse me. The speakers are, we are having a very eminent panel today as speakers, and I am welcoming each and everyone, starting with our chief guest today, Mr. Kumar Pushkar, IFS, Managing Director, Karnataka State Tourism Development Corporation. Welcome you, sir, to this webinar. And our speakers today are our own Rajan Shegal, our Delhi chapter, PRC Delhi chapter chairman, and he's also the chairman of Skill and Education Travel Agents Association of India. Dr. Devika Menon from Kerala, director, she is the director of Prince Travels Private Limited. Mr. Nagaraj Venkataraman, avid traveler, Mr. Nirmal D. Silva, Sri Lanka, one of the major destination Sri Lanka. He is the managing director of that company. Dil Bahadur Karki, he is the managing director of Nepal Memorable Tours Private Limited. Mr. Angan Ganguly, executive director of Maitirth India. And Lakshmi Sharat, she is a travel blogger and writer. On behalf of Public Relations Council of India, World Communicators Council, and Young Communicators Council, I am extending a very warm welcome to one and all. And also to the participants, our members, students, all are welcome to this webinar. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Dr. Vinay Kumar, National President, PRCI, to welcome all of us. We now have Mr. Ashish Tayal, who's the chairperson, Nagpur chapter. He's going to speak about WCC. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much, Mr. Nikhil. Am I audible?
Yes, you are, sir. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Respected chief guest of this webinar, Mr. Kumar Pushkar sir, our chief mentor and chairman emeritus, Mr. M.B. Jayaram sir, chairman governing council, Mr. B.N. Kumar sir, national president, Dr. T. Vinay Kumar sir, chairperson, YCC president, Ms. Geeta Shankar, our governing council, national council members, zonal heads, chapter heads, our honorable PRC and YCC members, and especially our special guests and speakers of this wonderful evening. Good evening to everyone present here. Friends, I am thankful to Bangalore chapter for giving me this opportunity to present a brief about WCC, that is World Communicators Council. We have gathered here to celebrate World Tourism Day with wonderful personalities present here with us this evening. Before we start celebration of World Tourism Day, this would be prudent to know the progress path of WCC in brief. Friends, the journey of PRCI began on 3rd March 2004 from its headquarters at Bangalore, broadly to enrich professional development and to provide networking opportunities to PR, media, advertising, marcom professionals and students. And soon it became premier and the most liked professional body of the country because of the dedication and love of its members. When the council rapidly spread its wings throughout the country, our mentors thought of taking the council to the next level with the mission to bring communication organizations and professionals together across the world for sharing knowledge, breaking barriers and frontiers, both physical and mental, and to contribute towards exchange of experiences and ideas to communicate for better world. So that the very vision of WCC to become a one-stop knowledge powerhouse in the field of mass communication for professionals, educationists, researchers and students across the world may be achieved, and overall progress of humanity may be ensured. This is how the World Communication Communicators Council was found with the headquarters at London. WCC is rapidly marching ahead with its mission and vision and presently operates with its chapters in UAE, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Nepal, and Bhutan. Soon, WCC hopes to spread its wings to many other countries, including Singapore, Australia, UK, and US. WCC offers an excellent opportunity to connect entire fraternity worldwide, which makes it unique. This is the only PR professional body of the country which has its reach in other countries too. The credit of this great success goes to our mentors who generated this wonderful opportunity for each member of the council to communicate for a better world. And of course, this could not have been possible without the enormous support and help of our honorable members. Young communicators, educators, educationists, and institutions associated with Public Relations Council of India. Thank you so much for listening to me. Over to Mr. Nikhil. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ashish Dayal. I once again request all the audiences to kindly mute their microphones so that we have a smooth webinar. Thank you so much. I now request Mrs. Pallavi Priyadarshini, Vice Chairperson, PRCI Bangalore, to speak about PRCI and YCC as well. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Nikhil. And I will actually, Ashish has really covered well about the PRCI, so I'll try to make it brief on that. So basically, Public Relations Council of India, PRCI, has a pan-India communication exchange forum with its presence in 38 Indian cities and towns. This premier network connects PR, media, commercial, public service advertising, market, academia in communication, and students. PRCI provides industry professionals an opportunity to serve their community by encouraging high ethical standards in their respective areas of work and is the first forum to offer accreditation to professionals in the stream. PRCI organizes at national and regional levels events like conferences, discussions, lectures, training programs for sharing experience and facilitate continuing education of like-minded professionals. Now, talking about YCC, which is an active initiative by PRCI, Young Communicators Club, the whole idea is to galvanize youngsters. YCC helps young people pursue their aspirations. We empower them to contribute to and benefit from the creation of more peaceful and prosperous communities. We especially focus on the youth who is pursuing mass media communication, HR, marketing programs across universities and colleges in India. We at YCC are committed to actively raising the quality of life for every student. Our mission is to make every student industry ready and employable. Thank you so much, Nikhil. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Pallavi Priyadarshini, on that insight into PRCI and YCC. All right, so we have, it's time to move on to our chief guest for this evening, for this international webinar. I'm very, very happy. On behalf of PRCI, I would like to invite Mr. Kumar Pushkar, who is an IFS officer, Additional Principal Chief Conservator of Forests and Managing Director of Karnataka State Tourism Development Corporation. Welcome, Mr. Kumar Pushkar, for this international webinar. We extend a warm welcome to you. And also, a little bit about Mr. Kumar. Mr. Kumar, after completion of postgraduate degree, completed a short course in remote sensing and GIS from University of Twente, Netherlands. He's held various posts related to forest protection, forest management, social forestry, etc. Also, he's worked as the executive director of Chamarajendra Zoological Gardens, Mysore. We all know that, and had proud achievements of making Mysore Zoo financially self-sufficient. That's a huge credit to him. Worked as a conservator of forests, director of Bandipur Tiger Reserve, special commissioner in finance in BBMP, also executive director of Jungle Lodges and Resorts, Department of Tourism, Karnataka. We extend a very warm welcome to Mr. Kumar Pushkar, IFS. Warm welcome to you, sir. Over to you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for inviting me. And I'm really privileged to be part of this webinar. Am I audible, Nikhil?
Yes, yes, sir. Please go ahead, sir.
Yeah, so at the outset, I would like to compliment everyone who is there on this webinar on the occasion of the World Tourism Day. In fact, we had a nice celebration this morning when the Honorable Chief Minister of Karnataka flagged off expedition of the bikers to Nandi Hills as well as to Mysore. In fact, the expedition which started for Mysore was all-woman group, and the theme was safe travel, safe tourism, and this is how we have been trying to promote tourism. The another great achievement on the day of World Tourism Day today has been the release of the Karnataka Tourism Policy. This policy is there now for the next 5 years, 2020 to 2025, and this would guide us to take Karnataka on a very sustained path of growth for its travel and tourism sector. Travel and tourism, probably all of you are aware, is a very, very important industry today. Many of the cities as well as countries have been fully dependent on tourism and have been growing well by promotion of tourism and the tourism infrastructure. Tourism is one sector which immediately provides job to large number of people, in fact directly as well as indirectly. So wherever we have tourism products, we automatically create the jobs without the government thinking about creating jobs. The jobs are automatically there in the market. If you look at the Indian scenario, we have close to almost 4 million people who are dependent on the tourism sector. The GDP-wise contribution of the tourism to the Indian economy is almost 10%, while in Karnataka it is 14.8% of the state GDP, which comes from the tourism sector. Almost 1.8 million people in Karnataka are directly or indirectly dependent on the tourism. So tourism, we all know that is a very, very important sector from the industry point of view. But apart from that, as an instinct, as a human instinct, this is, tourism is part of all of us. In fact, the invitation itself read, travel is life and life is travel. And that is what is very, very true. So all of us are actually traveling through the journey of life. But at the same time, all of us as an individual have a lot of interest in traveling to different places in this world. So that's what is basically the basic instinct of all of us. Talking about the impact of Corona or the COVID on the tourism sector, the sector which has been most widely affected, badly affected, is the tourism sector. This is one sector which normally gets affected in case of any of the local or the global disturbances. Whenever we see any flood or any kind of a law and order situation happening in any of the areas in Karnataka or in any part of the world, we find that the tourism immediately drops down in that particular region. But then at the same time, it bounces back also without any delay. As soon as the problem is taken care of, the tourism bounces back. In fact, recently, even the governor of the Reserve Bank of India, he was mentioning about tourism sector, that this is one sector where the revival will be like a V curve. So where the drop down has come down steeply, but then it will revive also very steeply like a V curve. Tourism, the theme today is a destination of tomorrow, and it's a very, very nice theme selected by the PRCI. Dr. Lata has been spearheading the Bangalore chapter. I had the pleasure and privilege of working with her when I was in BMTC. And in fact, she has been very, very active all the time, trying to bring different things together. And then in the state transport also, she was very successful in bringing very good name as well as lot of awards. So today, as part of PRCI, I must congratulate that she has done a wonderful job by organizing this webinar on the day, on the occasion of the World Tourism Day. And that also the topic is destination of tomorrow, tourism, the destination of tomorrow. And if we talk about what kind of a destination which we are going to basically project in the days to come, first of all, I would like to say that COVID is still on, and then whatever travel we do, we have to be extremely safe, we have to be extremely careful. we would not be telling everyone that tourism is getting affected and you should start traveling. That's not the thing which we can tell at the moment, but then things would definitely improve very shortly, where we will have some solution to corona, and that is the time when tourism needs to pick up. And then at that point of time, probably we would be focusing on the local destinations as well as the experiential destinations. We fully understand that as soon as the tourism starts, it will not be on the global scale as we had been doing in the past. It will be mainly focused at the local level. What we have seen after the unlocks which has been done over the past couple of months, that most of the people who are within the state, like people in Bangalore, prefer to travel to some of the destinations which they feel that that are safe, and their preferences are mainly in the western Ghats or in the forest areas. But with time, we will see that more and more people would start traveling within the country. But then the international travels will take a much longer time, and probably we will have to think of creating the travel bubbles between the two countries, where the safety, hygiene, and all those things will be put in place, and then we start having mutual kind of a tourism between the two bubbles. So that is what would be the future, where we would be concentrating first on the local tourism, and then slowly we'll start moving towards the global also. And the requirement of the tourism, probably all of us again understand that it's not the touch and go kind of a tourist who travel today. Earlier there used to be a checklist that I am going to travel for 7 days, and these are the different places which I am going to touch. Today people go out to have experiences. So people say that I am going to travel for 7 days and I would like to spend time seeing the heritage in Karnataka, wildlife in Karnataka or in India or for any such country. So the experience plays a very important role, and then we all need to gear up to ensure that the traveler who comes to a destination is given a good experience of the local culture, the tradition, and also the education with regard to the that particular place and their history. So that way the overall attitude in the tourism needs to change. Then the tourism development needs to be very, very collaborative. We have to involve the stakeholders in the planning process. The government, the industry, the communities need to work together. We also need to assess the carrying capacity of the tourist destinations, and also ensure that the tourism is distributed over the region rather than being located or focused at certain one or two spots only. Then we also would be focusing in the coming days on the social media as well as the media and promotion for the destinations support. So people in the private sector, probably all of us cannot make a pro bono advertisement at the global level. So as part of the government, we will be taking up that responsibility. We have been already doing it. Today also the Honorable Chief Minister has launched a special video which has been released on the Jog Falls, the Karnataka's Niagara Falls, that has been released, and it will be circulated on different media. So that is another very important role which we will play to ensure that the promotion of the destinations takes place. And we will also be working on a connectivity factor, which is very, very important for any destination. In Karnataka, we have been trying to basically put things very carefully for the tourism sector. The SOPs or the guidelines for the safety and hygiene has been put into place, and the entire industry, all the hotels, restaurants and the destinations are following those SOPs very carefully and very meticulously, and that is one of the reasons why I can tell with confidence that the Karnataka tourism is extremely safe. And if you travel to any of the destinations, you need not worry about the safety or hygiene against the coronavirus. We have also been using the Karnataka Tourism Society, which is a society formed out of the stakeholders, as our partner in providing a unified platform to engage with the industry. So we have made tourism planning and development much more collaborative. Consultation during the early days to understand the industry concerns has been done, and we have involved the industry in the formation of the SOPs also. We have also engaged with the industry to organize the Karnataka International Travel Expo last year, and we have already started the preparation for the 2021 edition of the Karnataka International Travel Expo. Future of tourism, basically, if we talk about tomorrow, we have to think about the good practices, then the sustainability of the tourism products, and the green practices to basically reduce the load on the environment, and also to ensure that the most more and more of the local people are involved in our tourism activities. So these would be the focus from the government side and from the private sector also in the coming days. I know that we all are going through a very, very tough phase, but then we should be prepared to survive for the next couple of months. Things should be fine. We have already gone through almost 6 months period, and we have survived. We will have to ensure that we survive for the next few days. In fact, in the first month of the lockdown, that was April, when we were having consultation with the private sector people, and we were thinking about making a revival plan that time. One of the stakeholders very clearly said, "Sir, revival plan comes later. First is the survival plan." And I totally agree that first is the survival. So we all need to survive. It's a difficult phase, and we have to have all the precautionary measures to ensure that we do not contract or spread COVID. And at the same time, wait for the right time when the tourism can be propagated. Yes, at the local level, wherever we feel that things are fine and safe, we can definitely travel, take a break, and then support this industry. But at the same time, let us wait, but then have the plans ready, so that as soon as the COVID starts going down, we should immediately pick up, and we should bounce back and come back to the same levels in which we were there probably in the month of the January this year. In fact, we have number of speakers today, and I would be also very keen on listening to them. So initially, I would like to wish all of you the very best, and my compliments on the day of the World Tourism Day to all of you. And I would sit and then watch the proceedings on this webinar. Wish you all the best. Thank you very much, Nikhil, as well as Dr. Lata.
Thank you so much, Mr. Kumar Pushkar, for your insights into tourism post-pandemic, during the pandemic as well, and also the plans that are being made by the government of Karnataka, Department of Tourism, to have a safe travel. All right, so moving on, we're going to have our super speaker. In fact, we want to call him the super speaker. I don't know why my video is off. Let me try and get it back. But okay, we have Mr. Rajan Sehgal. He's the chairman, Skill and Education Travel Agents Association of India. He's also the president, India Golf Tourism Association, chairman, PRCI Delhi chapter. He's also the co-founder of Passionals and also chairman, PRCI Delhi chapter, as I said, and co-chairman, PHDCCI, and member, FICCI Tourism C2 NR committee. Also member of the Manas committee under the AG's Ministry of Minority Government of India. He's also going to give us an insight into hospitality and tourism trends post-pandemic. Talking about technology today, because we had some technical issues for him to log in. But what I'm going to do is I have already dialed his number and I have him with me. We're going to do it over the telephone. We're going to attempt to using the technology to our maximum. So, Mr. Rajan Sehgal, please welcome to this international webinar.
Okay, thank you, Nikhil, for connecting me with my respect and regards to all the senior people from PRCI. Especially thanks to Bangalore PRCI chapter for organizing this wonderful webinar on World Tourism Day. I am not able to see you. Either I am a true follower of guidelines of COVID-19. It's not only the physical distance, but I am not even seeing eye to eye also. I just want to be more careful, you can say, but it's only a technical hitch, you know, which is keeping us away to seeing each other. So, I just want to tell you that it's a great honor to be on this platform with such learned and distinguished guests and the future of our travel and tourism industry. So, I just want to tell, because there are so many other speakers also, that some situations come in our life as blessings and some situations come in our life as lessons. The present one is a big lesson for the entire world. Nature was giving us, you know, so many warnings, so many messages, but everyone was busy in being number one, competing with each other in most unhealthy way. So in this lockdown of almost 6 months, when the entire world is at standstill, of course, the travel, tourism, and hospitality industries is also affected. So I think everybody has learned that it's a break. It's a break to respect the nature, to know that God is within us, safe and responsible living, increase your knowledge and talent during that break. And one has to become, I think this break has given us a lesson that we have to be multi-skilled and multi-talented. That will be the need of the future. And you know, there is a fear that travel and tourism, hospitality industry will not revive. But if they revive, they will be the last one. I don't agree with this. I am in this travel, tourism and hospitality business from last 40 years. Even I did my graduation, my post-graduation in tourism from Delhi University. And this is my fourth webinar today. I was with Maulana Azad, Abdul Kalam University this morning, West Bengal, then with Indian Institute of Travel Management and with Amity University. And the students were a little bit concerned whether they have chosen a right career or not as a travel, a tourism and hospitality. So I just want to tell them that, you know, in my last 40 years, I have seen so many ups and downs. The 9/11, the Iraq war, the 26/11, the swine flu, then we have this terror attacks. But our travel, tourism, hospitality industry always bounce back, you know. Because travel and tourism is related to each and everything. Earlier were the days when travel and tourism means making hotel booking, issuing airline tickets, making car rental bookings. But now tourism is connected with each and everything. You know, if you go for your some wedding, if you go to meet for some business meeting, if you go for a holiday, if you go and meet your relatives, it's all related to tourism. And especially in this time when there is a recession going on, when there is a big crisis in the world, you know, all the Europeans and other people, nationalities, they go in depression. But Indians always rush to God, you know, because we have so many gods in India. And Indians rush to God in the time of crisis. So I'm telling the students of this travel, tourism, hospitality industry that you become a pilgrimage tourism specialist. Make pilgrimage tour packages and sell as much as you can, because, you can make money. And as I told you that tourism is related to each and everything. It's whether it's a golf tourism, film tourism, wedding tourism, Ayurveda, yoga, natural tourism. I think this Ayurveda, yoga, nature is the need of the hour for tomorrow. And India is full of Ayurveda, yoga, natural tourism. And you know the recovery rate in India, because of the population, we have getting so many cases every day. But the recovery rate is also number one in the world, because we have these natural things which were falling from past, you know. So my only request to all my concerned travelers, people connected with travel, tourism and hospitality, that we will bounce back. And, you know, in the next few months, domestic tourism will start in a big way, because the country of the world has seen the power of Indian traveler, the potential of travel from India. You know, Indians are number one or two or three in countries like UK, Switzerland, France, Thailand, Malaysia, Dubai. You know, all the tourism boards have made their base in India from last so many years, because they know even small countries from all over the world have offices in India, because they know that Indians are ready to travel anywhere. And you know, our outbound is 3 times more than what we get inbound tourism. So all these outbound travelers who are in their house from last 6 months, they are ready to travel because of 6 months in their house. And can you believe, you know, that future destinations will be which are more easily connected by road, more open, close to nature, where you get fresh air and positive energy, nice food, and they are very safe and very hygiene. People will not go to big cities at the moment and stay in this 5-star hotel, big buildings. They want to go in an open resort. And I think India, and that way the rural tourism will play an important role. And as far as the village life of India or the small places in India are amazing, but we have not marketed them in a proper way. Right from Jammu and Kashmir to deep south in Kerala, we have wonderful places which we can promote as a rural tourism. You know, the backwaters of Kerala is a rural tourism because it's not a city. When you are moving in a houseboat, staying in a houseboat, moving from one place, from Kochi to Alappuzha to Kottayam to other places, you know, you are all going through the villages, the green areas, the green trees. So this is a tourism which we have not marketed so well, but Kerala has done wonderful job in promoting their country. And can you imagine the resorts which are open, fresh air, lots of greenery, close to nature around Delhi are totally sold out till the 15th of October from last 2 weeks, especially for the weekend and during the week also, because people want to go and stay in these kind of places. So I give you an example, Switzerland or France or Austria. You know, when Indians start going to Switzerland, UK, after the Bollywood has done lots of shootings in their country, and that Indians are crazy to see where the celebrities, the film stars have shot the film. So they want to go and see these places. So immediately Switzerland realized that we are getting too many tourists to Zurich and Geneva, and people can only understand that Switzerland means Zurich and Geneva. So they tried and promoted their small villages like Interlaken, Montreux, St. Moritz, and Lausanne, Mount Kittler. And you know, these places have become a household name in India. I was in Switzerland 25 years back to play a golf event. And after a game of golf, you know, I was moving around in this village called Interlaken. It's a very small village. And, you know, in the evening, I saw 2 loads of buses with Indian tourists 25 years back in Interlaken. And I asked the tour leader, how come these Indians are here in this place which is not known at the moment in India? And which part of India they belong to? He said, these people, it's an entire big family from Rajasthan, and it's a small village called Sikar. And I said, who told them about this place in Switzerland? They said, the children were watching some Indian Bollywood film of Govinda, and you know, they were very curious to see these beautiful places, and they found out where that shooting was held. So you can see the power of film tourism, how they can promote a particular destination. Now, Indians have been the frequent traveler at least 6 to 7 times to these Interlaken, Lausanne. These are small villages, you know, which are now made a beautiful tourism places. Similarly, in India, the example, we start from Jammu and Kashmir when the things will get normal. When I was doing my graduation in tourism, 6 of our students from our class, we decided that we should take a project during our summer vacation. So we went by train from Delhi to Jammu, and after taking the blessings of Mata Vaishno Devi, we said, why don't we trek from Jammu to Srinagar? Either we'll walk or we'll take some lift from some car or some bus or some truck wala, and we'll make this journey in 10 to 12 days. And can you imagine the journey from Jammu to Kashmir, if you really take it now also when the things will get normal, you will see a small beautiful villages called Patni Top, Banihal, Kut, Fazikund, and from Srinagar, when you go to Gulmarg, Pahalgam, and Sonmarg, there are beautiful small villages with beautiful places to stay, homestay, where you can really enjoy the stay and your food, fresh food, you can get it. And I'll give you another example, like I'm in Delhi, based in Delhi, and when we are just outside, go out from Delhi on the Delhi-Jaipur highway, just 50 kilometers from Delhi, there is a road which goes inside a small village. And, you know, on that stretch of 10 kilometers road, that is totally sold out from last 1.5 months till end of October, because it is all surrounded by village, beautiful fields. People can see a lot of nature, Aravalli Hills, and there are 4 beautiful resorts and golf courses are there, and people are, you know, going and staying and enjoying their life after this lockdown in this close to the nature. Then in Bangalore also, you know, when we have places like Hampi is coming in a big way. When you travel from Bangalore to Goa or Goa to Bangalore by road, the places on the way which one can see, the small, small places, used to be villages, but now they are small cities like Vellore, Hassan, Hampi, Hospet. They are amazing. You know, amazing. If we Kodaikanal, Uti, people, if we promote them and market them, just relying on Delhi, Agra, Jaipur, Golden Triangle. Our tourism industry is mainly relying on Delhi, Agra, Jaipur, Delhi. I was with the Secretary of Madhya Pradesh Tourism few days back, and we had a closed-door webinar with Vicky and Madhya Pradesh Tourism. I told them that we have a Golden Triangle, Delhi, Agra, Jaipur, but in Madhya Pradesh, you have a Diamond Triangle, which is when people are coming to Agra, why don't you bring them from Agra to Gwalior, which is 1 hour train journey, and from Gwalior to Orcha, Orcha to Khajuraho. Khajuraho, you must have heard. It's an amazing place, heritage place, temple. There is a population of just 1.5 lakh over there. One of the best airport in India. One of the neat and cleanest railway station in India. And, you know, you can see stars in the night when you visit the temples of Chandela dynasty. I think it's amazing. But only thing is we are not marketing. We are just concentrating on important cities. And we have so much of, you know, nature, history, heritage. Go to Rajasthan, Shekhawati region. It's a small village. And people have now converted their havelis, and royal families have converted their small royal houses into hotels. And, you know, before COVID, I have one of the richest golfers from UK on a 12-day golfing tour of India. And I took them to 5 different golf courses to play. And I took them to Jaipur also. And I, after a game of golf, I arranged a dinner at Samos Palace with the royal family. And the ladies from the royal family were serving them dinner, showing them Diwali festival. The next day, they celebrated Holi for them. And, you know, they got amazed. They said, we play, Mr. Saigal, golf at one of the best courses in the world, but after playing a game of golf, we just go back to our hotel in the room or maybe eat something, that's all. But in India, you can offer us so many things, you know, which we can't imagine. The Surajkund Mela, the annual Surajkund Mela, where the entire village life, all the states of India comes for 14 to 15 days. There is a Bharat Parv at the lawns of India Gate, which the Ministry of Tourism organized, where all the craftsmen, they come with their creative work. The Ministry of Minority organized Hunar Haat, where all the craftsmen from all over India came. I think if we promote these kind of places and these events to the first to the Indian traveler from Gujarat, they can come to Rajasthan. Rajasthan, they can go to Central India, South India. You know, near Mumbai and Pune, Nasik, we have beautiful vineyards. You know, we have wine tours in south of France, but we have lots of vineyards, beautiful nature, resorts near Nasik. You know, only thing is, we are not promoting or marketing them. So I have given a detailed report to Ministry of Tourism that if we start promoting on these kind of things, and this is the place where future Indian traveler and foreign traveler will be looking. And the entire world has seen that India has something to keep people healthy, the recovery, why the recovery rate is so good, because our Ayurvedic center, our naturopathy in Kerala is amazing. If you visit the Ayurvedic resorts in Kerala, they will pull with United Arab Emirates, Saudi Arabia, richest people, they come there and spend 2 to 3 weeks and take positive energy for their future.
Mr. Rajan,
we can promote. And I will now, you know, ask my other speakers to come. And
yes,
that's what I want to say, that tourism will revive in a big way.
Thank you, Mr. Rajan. That was a very, very insightful talk on tourism. Thank you so much for connecting to us using the technology. Thank you once again. All right, then, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to move forward, and without wasting any more time, we're really falling short of time here. So we're going to move on to our first speaker for this international webinar. That's Dr. Devika Menon. She's the director of Princey World Travels Private Limited. The topic is ecotourism, changing the narrative from making destinations to hosting the hosts. She's a professional with 3 decades of experience in the tourism industry. Presently, she's the director of Princey World Travels Private Limited, travel agency in Kochi. She holds a doctorate in tourism. She's a certified corporate director by the Institute of Directors, New Delhi, recognized by the Ministry of Culture, Arts and Tourism, Malaysia, 2003, Tourism Authority of Thailand, 2010, and also Department of Tourism, Government of Australia, 2018. And I request the audience to post their questions in the chat box for Dr. Devika Menon. And I request all our esteemed speakers today to try and, maximum time limit of 10 minutes, including question and answers, because we're really falling short of time. Apologies for that. Over to Dr. Devika Menon.
Good evening, and wishing you all a very happy Tourism Day. Thank you, Nikhil. I'm deeply honored by your introduction. It is an honor to be here in the company of such talented tourism professionals. I'm also grateful to the PRCI team for giving me this international platform to share my experience and learn from my peers. We have all created travel itineraries for different types of clients. Typically, these itineraries focus on the main tourist attractions in an area and involve city tours, shopping, eating in centrally located restaurants, and viewing standardized cultural programs. Thus, most tourist visits crowded cities, walk along congested streets, inhaling polluted fumes, and spend time stuck in traffic, adding to the already high levels of carbon emission. The mass commercialization of tourism and its ecological burden has led to a gradual shift to a more meaningful and personalized travel experience that emphasizes the creation of shared memories. This transformation has put the spotlight on an innovative concept, hosting the host. In this novel concept, the tourist is not a passive actor who transits through a destination by being a token participant in its sights, sound, and beauty. Instead, she actively scripts her own unique experience by immersing herself in the lifestyle and culture of the host community. We have a familiar picture of visitors. They are paying customers whose wishes must be fulfilled by the host community. They are entitled to make demands from the host community, but usually have no corresponding obligations towards them. The visitor host is very different from this. She plays a dual role. The visitor host receives hospitality from the host family and also serves as a host to the hosting family. This duality places obligations on the visitor as well as on the host. They are expected to be respectful to the host family and their culture. Their attitude and behavior should be in harmony with the cultural values of the destination community, and they should engage in shared social activities. For example, join the host family in collecting vegetables, fruits from the orchard, and cooking it together, enjoying a shared local festival or event, which is of great significance to the host family. Visitor host may also offer thoughtful gifts to the hosting family. The focus here is on creating experiences on both sides. The visitor host gets an opportunity to immerse herself in a totally new way of life. Simultaneously, the hosting family reaps an unexpected experience from the hospitality of the visitor host. This reciprocal creation of experiences with reverberating memories in the mind of the visitor host and the hosting family is the essence of experiential tourism. We are familiar with some aspects of experiential tourism in the context of homestay tourism. As you can see, the emphasis is on experiences. Therefore, the host community should create a shared story for the visitor host to be part of. Modern life has led to the loss of traditions, rituals, folklore, and eroded connections between people. Unfortunately, this disconnect is not an ideal foundation for building experiential tourism. The host community should not consist of disconnected individuals. Rather, they should be thriving local units that are strongly connected to the larger community and the culture around them. I would like to conclude my talk by inviting all of you to visit my vibrant state of Kerala, labeled God's own country. You can treat yourself to a wide array of experiences. Design an exquisite flower carpet to usher in the harvest festival of Onam, sail down the tranquil backwaters, enjoy a traditional Kerala meal with the locals, ride on an elephant, and take in the lush greenery of our verdant landscape, which makes it an appropriate destination for ecotourism. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Devika Menon. In fact, it's been a while since I rode an elephant. So it brings back my childhood memories of my touring experience to Kerala. Nowadays, we go for only shooting to Kerala. But yes, of course, that's an important aspect that you mentioned. In fact, I have a question. Quickly, we'll take a question for you as well. And in your view, how is hosting a host experience similar or is it different from the homestay concept? That's my question for you.
The similarity is that in both cases, the visitor stays in a house or an apartment along with all the members of the hosting family. Okay. The homestays are generally located in suburbs or countrysides if the visitor right. intends to do so, or they can have for a more eco-friendly holiday. Right. Else, homestays are available in the cities as well. The main right. difference is that the visitor themselves play host to the real host in the concept of hosting the host, wow. whereas in the case of a homestay, the role and responsibility of extending hospitality to the visitor is solely on the host.
Wow, wonderful. That's a very well answered question. All right, just one more quick thing. Have you had any personal experience during any of your trips abroad? And in your opinion, how best do you think it would be to support ecotourism? You know, in short, if you can answer that.
Yeah. In fact, in one of my tours to Australia in 2018,
okay.
We were taken to destination called Bowrel in Southern Highlands.
Okay.
And I must say that is one of the best tours of my life I've had.
Okay.
The reason being we had a very different and great experience.
Mm-hmm.
We were taken by a coach on a Grand Pacific ride. It's okay. called the Grand Pacific Route.
Mm-hmm.
The route alone is about 140 kilometers.
Wow.
And from Sydney, we went in a coach till about, we reached a Royal National Park. And from there, we were split into groups. We had a mini coach for ourselves. We were about 20 of us or so. And on reaching the park, we were further divided into two, into pairs.
Right.
And though we traveled for some distance, we mm-hmm. were stopped at a particular place and the pairs were asked to get out of the coach. And to our surprise, we were taken for a 45 minutes ride on a Harley Davidson.
Wow.
It was just an amazing experience with, you know, passing through the coastline. It was a beautiful right. coastline.
Right.
And unbelievable experience. Right. Really had jaw-dropping ocean views. Rainforests, right. charming right. coastal towns and cities. And we were taken then to a host family where right. we were supposed to stay with them for a night.
Okay.
and they were very hospitable. They came and picked us up again. From there, we were divided into three, actually, into three, and we were taken. Okay. They came and picked us up, and they took us around, and we reached their home, and we sort of settled down in their beautiful antique. They had a lot of, artifacts and all that well arranged. We got a time to see. They had a lot of animals in their farm. So we spent time feeding it. Then in the evening, we cooked our own meal. We barbecued the chicken.
Sure.
Next morning, we took eggs from the coop and we had for breakfast along with,
So basically, what you're trying to say in a nutshell, I can say that you support ecotourism. So that's the best thing that can happen.
Very much, very much.
Okay.
There's no pollution at all and there's no waste. They have their own compost and the rest
fantastic.
Is thank you.
Fantastic. Fantastic. Thank you so much, Dr. Devika Menon, the insights of ecotourism. And also, I have a lot of people responding on the chat box as well, saying their experiences of staying with families and when they went to when they went abroad or when they went to on a tour. So thank you so much for your insights, Dr. Devika.
Thank you.
All right. So we're going to move on to our next speaker for this international webinar today. May I invite Mrs. Lakshmi Sharath, who's a travel writer, blogger, photographer, media professional. In fact, the topic she's going to be talking on is COVID-19, what it means for travel, PR, and communication. In fact, Mrs. Lakshmi Sharath is a travel writer, blogger, and she's a media professional who worked for 15 years in several media organizations. She had passion to write, blog, to share her travel experiences. The blog, www.lakshmisharath.com, has won several accolades, including winning the Indie Bloggies, India's best travel blog of the year. So I'm going to hand over the mic to Mrs. Lakshmi Sharath. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Nikhil. That's really overwhelming. Thank you, everybody on the panel, and thank you so much for inviting me here. I must say that talk by Ms. Devika Menon really made me want to travel and not sit here, because she really, made me feel that I really want to get on to my travels. And I did remember some of the amazing experiences I've had with hosts, even in both India and abroad. But anyway, my topic is about communications. And I think COVID is obviously one of the key things that's happened because of the pandemic, is that what I call the information highway is completely broken down. I mean, there is absolutely no clue what's happening anywhere. I mean, whatever information we are getting is bits and pieces. We are getting information which is not clear anywhere. We do have some information coming in terms of protocols. We do have some positive stories coming here and there. We do have guidelines coming in. But I think there is nothing which is to a large extent, the content is not, the communication and content is not clear. It's not channelized, whether it's India, whether it's abroad, or whether it's a hotel, whether it's a tourism board. And this is where I think there is a need to kind of not only have a content channel, but also to kind of streamline this content, to have it absolutely clear. There is a content which is updated regularly. Like, for example, I'll tell you, it's not from a travel perspective. I have to go to Chennai next week. And I just came back 2 weeks ago. And I still don't know whether I need an e-pass or not. So while Bangalore didn't need, Chennai, it's still on the site, it says that it's required. But I'm told that we don't know whether from October whether it's required or not. So there are a lot of gray areas. And of course, there are areas with respect to whether in flights are started or not, whether what are the protocol guidelines here. So there is a lot of content, a lot of things which are also very dynamic. So I personally feel that the entire challenge is going to be for someone to kind of not only have a content, content and communications, which is going to be clear, but it's also going to be updated regularly, because things are very dynamic as we speak. Things are changing as we speak. So that to me is one of the first points that we need to have. We need to, first of all, streamline communications, and we need to ensure it's updated regularly. And every stakeholder, it's not just the government. You may be a property, you may be a traveler, you may be an airport, you may be a tourism board. I think everybody needs to have a structured communication channel which is open, and that is the need of the hour. The second important aspect here, if I may say, is the role of stories and storytellers. So I was just on a previous panel a little while ago, and everybody was talking about the trust factor. Everybody is afraid to travel. Everybody is worried what is happening on the other side. Everybody wants to travel, but there is a lot of fear to travel. How do we bring this, how do we deal with this trust factor? How do we ensure that we create positive stories? How do we create real, authentic stories? I was reading a site earlier by British Columbia. They have created in Canada an entire organized, they've tied up with an entire organization which is working on resilience for small and medium enterprises, hotels, small retail organizations, everybody who's dependent on tourism in that area. And they're sitting and working with them on a one-on-one case basis. And each of the story is being documented. What is being done? How safe are they? It could be a ranch, for instance. It could be a small retail shop. It could be a distillery. It could be a farm. So all of these, their stories, how they're being safe, what are the protocols that are being done? And this is where I think narratives become very, very, very important. This is where storytellers like us, writers, bloggers, media professionals, influencers, we become stakeholders here because we are like the messengers. We are like the winged messengers. Taking these stories across, this is where our role comes in, where we are going to be the channel of communication. We are going to be bringing in more positive stories. Yes, at one level, we are going to be talking a lot about information, which is hardcore information. But at another level, we are going to be talking about positive stories, positive narratives. And that is, these are the two dual challenges that I think and the need of the hour for communications today in the current scenario.
Thank you so much on that. I like the fact that the word challenges kept coming up. So because COVID-19 in itself is a huge challenge posed to the humanity, actually, the human race. Now, my question is, what will be the major communication challenges as the recovery begins? Because right now, I believe that we are still not at the recovery stage, looking at the number of cases across the world.
I think India is going to be the number one, believe it or not, in terms of cases. Now we are going to, it's not a great achievement, but we are going to overtake US. So the reason I use the word challenge is because currently everything is scattered. There is no uniform voice anywhere. Even organizations and rightfully so, you can't blame anybody. Everybody's figuring out what to do. People have to unlearn from where they started.
Absolutely.
And there is a lot of new things you are facing. So I think the key challenge here would be to probably, first of all, streamline content, just create a channel of communication. So if you're a hotel, for instance, if you're a tourism board, if you're a government, first have a clear communication channel where you probably update on a weekly basis. Like somebody was telling, one of the hotel partners was saying in the previous panel about how road trips have started, how many people have started entering in.
Right.
So I think the first challenge would be to have like a proper streamlined content which is available. The second key challenge, and which we all deal with, is fake news, right?
Yes, I was about
I think that is the biggest challenge. Yes. Like you have to, wade through the plethora of content and take the relevant content and put it out there. So it is very, very important to kind of focus on the actual content and not a lot of fake news. And third, like I said, powerful narratives. Right. I think that is totally something that we all... Because that's where the media comes in. That's where writers, bloggers, influencers, that's where we come in. Because we are the ones who know how to put this in the form of stories, put this in the form of content in various platforms and channels that we have. So the need for narratives is very, very important at this point of time.
Right. In fact, looking at this, do you think how is it going to impact the industry and the communications industry in the long term and the way forward, actually? Because everybody's looking, the way forward posts, COVID-19. So what will be the impact to the industry?
I don't know the impact because your guess is as good as mine, because we do not know the impact of COVID in the first place, let alone know the impact of what is going to happen to communications. Sure. But I think this is the time we need to step up our role, because I think... While everybody is firefighting out there, I think communications professionals and content and creators have the most important role to play here, because we are anyway on the sidelines and we are the ones who are, collating the content and putting it together. And like I said, if we are attached to a particular media house, or if you have your own platforms like blogs, or you're doing a podcast, or you're on social media, I think it's important to do that. And if you're attached to a particular hotel, if you're the communication head of a hotel, or if you're the communication head of a social of a tourism board, these have to be the regulations. All of this has to be put up regularly updated, it had to be like, in fact, I have been doing a lot of workshops recently on how content marketing is so important. However, in fact, I've been talking to a lot of travel entrepreneurs because this is the time for them to, when I say content marketing, it's not just about marketing your content, it's about marketing your brand using content. So you're actually, it's actually replaced traditional advertising because content has got a huge role to play. And in a large sense, that's communication study. So I think that, if you ask me for an implication, I think that is going to be the implication.
All right. Thank you so much, Ms. Lakshmi Sharad, on what it means for travel and PR and communication post the pandemic. Great insights into that subject. Thank you so much for your presentation today on this international webinar. Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to have you today.
Thank you so much. Having me here. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. We're going to move on to our next speaker for this evening. In fact, I'd like to mention we're running really short of time. I request all the speakers, to kindly maintain the time limit of less than 10 minutes. I'd like to welcome Mr. Dil Bahadur Karki from Nepal. He's the Managing Director, Nepal Memorable Tours Private Limited. He's going to talk about global perspective, shaping the tourism of tomorrow. Hospitality and tourism need to address global fear and economy. And also, he provides travel tours, trekking services, accommodation, specialized support for professionals like researchers, documentary filmmakers. Yeah, just like me in Nepal. He also promotes tourism activities in post-conflict affected areas, earthquake affected districts of Nepal. He was logistic officer at International Center for Transitional Justice, project administrator at Peace Brigades International, also tour officer at Basanta Adventure and Expedition Private Limited. So, Mr. Dil Bahadur Karki, the microphone is over to you.
Hi, good. Thank you, sir. It's my great pleasure to attend this webinar, and thank you so much for PRCI India to attend me to be a part of this program. So I didn't have this tourism reshaping of the tourism of tomorrow COVID-19, when there was an outbreak of this virus from the China, and I had a kind of sense of thing that it will be affected the world wise, but it comes in this way. So I have some to save the tourism, to save the tourism for tomorrow. I have a few points. Such as we should have a concrete plan, should be made for the reopening or shaping. It should be communicated to the concerned stakeholder for different communication and advocacy channels. Once this COVID is over, or once we are ready to move on the tourism activities, so we should have a very clear communication through the different channels, and we should have a very good advocacy worldwide. Is to travel is safe? Where to travel means if you are traveling Delhi to Kathmandu, means you should have a very good information of Kathmandu. Means your challenge starts from you're booking your plan. Then you are asking the taxi to pick up. You are going to the airport and you're flying and receiving from the airport and transferring the hotels and next day all the activities. So that it has to be very well advocacy. And second point, a special package should be provided to the tourism industry that is badly affected.
Thank you.
This is the pandemic and all the industries, tourism industry is very, very, it has a big impact on it. Everybody is, they are losing their job, they are losing their, space of work and thing. So, to save it, we should have a very, very good package for them. It's my understanding. Number third, it's a security and safety measures should be followed strictly so that there will be a confidence and trust among the client who the prime stakeholder of the trip. Of course, it's clients are the prime source, to move on the tourism. So we should have a very, we should have a very clear and we should have a very strict, protocol regarding the all the this hygienic and the sanitizer and everything. So they must be they should trust us, they should believe us, how thing to move on. And of course this pandemic has everywhere, nobody knows when this can be over. And so we need to be very, very careful. I think these are the points. So I just noted it down. I just prepare for it. I oversee it. I think this is it.
Sure, sir. Just when you were talking about, you know, strict protocols to be followed, what would be regional cooperation towards restoration from, say, associated sectors like hospitality, or it could be even, you know, transportation for that matter, you know, tourism, towards tourism ecosystem? What do you think of that?
It must be, you know, there must be the cooperation, regional cooperation, such as, you know, we can use both dual country means Nepal and India or other countries. Right. They can use their channel to coordination with, or they can we talk about the SAC, you know, SAC. Right. I mean, we can use that channels. They have their decks to see. They can collect all the correct information how they are operating it. Let's see if from India, Nepal, if you want to have a very, you know, solid information of Nepal, how the protocol they are applying for it, so they can, people can go, or I mean, regional organization can go through the SAC or other, you know.
Because every country is handling, you know, the COVID crisis in their own protocols, in their own fashion, because, you know, that's how every country is working on it. So that was exactly my question, you know, in terms of regional cooperation, you know, trying to restoration and trying to have the restoration from, you know, sectors like hospitality and transportation. So thank you so much for your insights into tourism, Mr. Dilkarki. It's great to have you on this international webinar. Thank you so much for your insights, you know, on the global perspective, shaping of tourism tomorrow. Pleasure to have you. All right. We're going to move on to our next speaker for this evening. We have Mr. Nagaraj Venkateshan. He's a technologist from Microsoft Singapore. Like we said, this is an international webinar. We have, speakers from various parts of the globe. So we now have Mr. Nagaraj Venkateshan. He's also a technologist working for Microsoft, 15 years of experience in data and artificial intelligence technologies. He's also a two-time Microsoft Most Valuable Professional Award winner. He's a regular speaker also at several international conferences. So he's also an avid traveler across the globe. I have to mention that, so because it's World Tourism Day, and what better platform for me to mention. So over to you, Mr. Nagaraj Venkateshan.
Thanks a lot. Thanks, Nikhil, for the excellent introduction. Wonderful to be speaking with you all. So typically, I find myself speaking on technical conferences. This is a different experience. So and I also loved Nikhil's presence of mind to use technology to manage one of the speakers could not connect. You have a strong hand, mate. So well done. So getting to the subject. So I will keep it short. Wonderful points mentioned by several speakers. I really loved the speech given by Mr. Pushkar from KSRTC industry. KSRTC, it was excellent. So to the rest of the speakers as well, I loved their content as well. What I would like to add over here is the importance of data. What data and what is its importance in tourism industry? So data, as you know, is the new oil, or they call it the new oil, that is the most valuable asset. And every organization, irrespective of which industry they belong to, the key thing is how they actually leverage the data to their advantage.
Sorry, may I request all the audiences to please mute? Mr. Javed, I think, please, can you please mute your microphone, please?
Okay. No worries. So data is the new oil. If you look at what are the most valuable companies which are actually making lot of profit in the recent years, look at things like in the tourism industry. If you think, who is making most of the money? A company like Airbnb, right? How much of hotels do they own? How much of property do they own? None. So, or in transport industry, something like Uber is making so much of money. So it's, again, intelligent use of the data, intelligent use of technology, and how you can leverage and gain use it to your advantage. And it matters a lot more right now because as when it comes to pandemic, and when it comes in these scenarios where you need to be, it is too hard for you to do things physically, and leveraging technology matters a lot more, having the right platform, having the right tools. So what do you have? You have things. One, if you are running a business, if you are a businessman, make sure you digitalize your business. Make sure you grab the data, try to gain insights out of it, apply concepts of artificial intelligence. One of the best things is you have technology like cloud, which makes all these things readily available. Whether you're a small business, you can afford to pay your probably few thousand rupees or a month to even do things like artificial intelligence. Or if you're a huge business, you can invest as much as you want. Technology is not restricted to big players. It is there for everyone. You have cloud, which lets you to keep your expenses in a subscription based model and so on. So I love the fact that KSR, Mr. Pushkar and the KSRTC team is actually thinking of going local more when it comes to tourism. Yes, that's the way people are doing. For example, I work very closely with the New Zealand and market around IT and technology. Tourism is 20% of their GDP. What they are doing is because they have already fought the COVID almost to zero cases. So they are already open, but completely locally. So they promote their local tourism very aggressively. My colleagues, my friends in New Zealand, they have started traveling all over the place. And yes, things are looking good. I'm pretty sure that would be the same thing in India as well. Concentrate a lot more locally. Try to find out if you are in the business of doing travel and tourism and so on, try to find out how you can attract local tourists. What is the hidden gem? What does your local tourist generally like? Out of the typical common ones, what are the other things that you can market? How can you use the data? How can you identify your potential tourists? All these kind of questions are the ones that the team people should be doing, in my opinion. Okay, I wanted to keep it short, but I would like to take up questions, I'm pretty keen to interact with.
Yes, sure. We'll do that because, again, like we said, we're falling short of time. So we'll try and give you a couple of questions. All right. My question, which I was thinking about when you're talking about technology. Now, my question is how technology can actually help the travelers. You know, we're talking from a very practical point of view because all I've used is, maps. So I use a Google map and that's my, technology at my best. So,
Good question. So nice that you have brought it in. Like the other speaker, Sharath, Ms. Sharath, when she was actually speaking, she was talking about having the right information, how it can help the travelers. We don't have the clarity in terms of communication and so on. Think of this. Don't think of websites where somebody needs to go and get a... If Google can give you a personalized news, right? Depending upon what you search, they can give... Why not KSRTC can give your personalized update, your bulletin update? Don't think of making your traveler go to the website, check the right news. One way to fight, if you are a service provider, go personalized. Again, the power is data. Know your traveler, get the right data, have the technology, don't think of doing it manually, get the technology to send out those notifications directly to the right people at the right time. So
I think there are a lot of people, in fact, who actually get irritated with those messages that keep popping up with the notifications. I think most of us find that a little annoying when you get those notifications when you don't need them. Maybe you already have the information. So I guess streamlining that would also help the travelers. Absolutely.
Again, why do you get so much of junk? Because it's not personalized. Okay, send it out to everyone, right?
Exactly. So that's the streamlining that's needed.
Yep.
Okay. Just quickly, one more question I have for you is, what is the overall role of technology in tourism? We've heard you say about data. We've heard you say about personalizing the data to the respective travelers. What do you think role of technology in tourism way forward is what I'd like to know.
Okay. Way forward, you see, technology has been part and parcel of the tourism industry, and it's going to be the same way. So when we talk of way forward immediately, possibly somebody is having a technical issue. If you are into the business of travel, trying to know what kind of users you need to attract after tourism, right? In 6 months down the line, how do I predict how much of people are going to come for a traveler? Probably the trust factor is a lot more. Okay. I used data. So I share my data, whether all my information is protected, whether my travel agent, are they certified for GDPR, do they have the privacy laws in place? Have they been right. audited for privacy? Is my data safe? Those right. kind of things. So yeah, you have a million ways you can apply it, and but we have only few seconds to talk about it. But yes, the possibilities are immense.
I agree with you. The possibilities are immense. And also you spoke about data privacy, which was running on my mind, which runs on everybody's mind. You Absolutely. Know, data privacy is the key right now because we're living in a world of technology at the yep. moment. And you know, that's what we're using to, in fact, fight COVID-19 in a way, you know, trying yep. to be safe and do that. All right. Thank you, Mr. Nagaraj Venkateshan, for your insights. He's from Singapore and he's a technologist, works for Microsoft Singapore. All right. Insights into that. Amazing. All right. We're going to move on to our next speaker. He's Mr. Ankan Ganguly. He is the executive director of My Tirth India Group. The topic would be religious and spiritual tourism, a future-oriented approach. In fact, Mr. Ankan Ganguly, the founder of My Tirth India Group, started India's first comprehensive religious pilgrimage site. Any temple, any pilgrimage, any yatra from travel to hotels to fooding to darshan and the puja to yagna to vidhi and sevas. I think that's a complete package, if I can mention. You know, they're doing it for across 50 major temples in India. Customized and personalized travel, special care for elderly, home-to-home service. Wow, post COVID-19, I must say they've in fact started online puja as well. There you go. That's the religious angle to it. And also the spiritual angle as well. And they have a comprehensive astrology and Ayurvedic site in one platform. So over to you, Mr. Ankan Ganguly. I know time is short, but you know, we'd like to know the insights of religious and spiritual tourism. Over to you.
Yeah, I'll keep it as short as possible. If you look at the entire religious market in India, you'll actually appreciate the fact that the as per the World Tourism Council, the Indian religious market is worth $247 billion as of 2019 and is poised to grow to $452 billion by the time we catch up 2022, which also contributes to 9% of India's GDP. And the phenomenal pace that is being, the religious tourism is kind of taking shape. We are also very thankful for the part that the government is kind of playing a very incidental part in this. The government would mean that there is a Prasad scheme, which is a pilgrimage augmentation drive. There is the Hriday program, the Heritage City Development Augmentation Yojana, the Swadesh Darshan Yojana. So, I mean, if you look at this entire, $250 billion of business, about 70% of this business is religious tourism. And this, through ages, has been, a kind of a cool product where people have gone across and has strengthened the belief that in times of need, in times of panic, in times of what we are going through today, people will go across to their divine and say, "Let this be done." Am I audible?
Yes, you are. Please go ahead. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So because it's a pull product and because it's like people going across and, having this, thing whereby people go back. So even if it's a disorganized market as it is today, as per the Lok Niti study that we did it with Google last year, we find that almost 2 million people visit temples in India every day. That's astonishing statistics, which means that during the times that COVID we actually had, this many number of people could not have gone to the temples. And hence the necessity of e-puja, which we already know is a $40 billion industry in India today. So the very fact that people cannot go to a temple, people cannot go across and visit the divine, the online puja segment has been the cornerstone or the foundation of people getting to see their pujas, the aarti, the havan, the yoga, whatever they want to do it, they can actually do it sitting at the comforts of home. Because this is something that you don't need to tell people to go across to a temple. People do it by themselves. So this spiritual market is one, because there is a shortage of time and kind of trying to squeeze in as many points as possible. The spiritual market is again something which is else, because the spiritual market can actually talk about Ayurveda and astrology, because the astrology market is worth, like $4.5 billion in India. The Ayurvedic market is worth $30 billion in India. So if you consider the kind of mammothness of the industry, post-COVID, you will find that people will, first of all, the fastest pickup in the industry, which will happen, will have to be the religious and the spiritual market, because it is not through design. It is not a sizzling Goa or amazing Rajasthan people would want to visit. It's basically the temples that people would want to go. And if 70% of $250 billion industry is religious tourism, I am sure for certain that 80 to 85% of the entire populace will be towards religions and religious and spiritual tourism. And so that kind of encapsulates it.
All right, thank you so much. I have just one question, you know, which popped up on my mind. I was thinking about, when we talk about, you know, religious and spiritual tourism as such, I was thinking, what is the scope of growth in the actual religious and spiritual industry as such? Because today we've, you know, that's an industry on its own. So, you know, what is the actual scope of growth? Can we talk like, you know, post-pandemic maybe, or, you know, even during the COVID-19 stage that we are in?
So I actually have a you know, a study from InstaMojo, which I actually was seeing just, you know, half an hour before. It actually said that, you know, during the times when the lockdown kind of, you know, came off and we were basically getting into the normalization of life, the only industry, as we call it, went across and did more than others was the spiritual market. People, you actually found out empty malls, but you actually had congested temples, congested queues in front of temples, people queuing up. So, you know, that was the most important differentiator, that people will go by themselves because this is what they have done for ages. So that's one. And secondly, it's very important that once online puja is there and people are seeing that, they would want to, because Indians by nature are basically people who want to have the feel and the, you know, the feel of the temple, the feel of the place, the feel of the courtyard and the divine. So they would want to go across and express themselves, go there in the temples. And, you know, so once the lockdown ends, once the various states go across, you will find there is a huge surge in terms of religious market and the spiritual market, which consists of Ayurveda, which consists of yoga, which consists of astrology and many more.
I think that's pretty much the instinct, the human instinct is to have those sense organs, you know, kind of activated, you know, because, you know, we'd like to touch and feel, you know, we go to the temple, we, you know, we smell the arati or we smell the kapur and we have the touch and feel. And that's when the faith and the belief increases is what I, you know, personally feel. All right. In fact, thank you so much for your insights into this aspect of tourism. I want to ask you, if you have to sum it up for today, what would be that one word or one sentence that you would like to say about this international webinar today? I know it's tough, one word or one sentence, maybe. Yeah.
For me, it's ecstatic, and for universality, I think it's mind-boggling. I mean, it's beyond being informative. So to me, it's been a mind-boggling session for the last 1.5 hours.
Totally appreciate it. Thank you so much for your time, and thank you for your insights into the tourism. Thank you so much. All right, so do we have Dr. Devika, the other speaker from Kerala, is she around as well? Dr. Devika, are you there?
Yes, Nikhil, very much.
Yes, here. Can I have your one word or one sentence for today's international webinar, please?
Well, it's indeed a great interactive global platform for exchange of ideas and knowledge from around the world. I really enjoyed it. Excellent.
Thank you so much for your feedback. Any other speaker whom we still have, or do we have Nagaraj, Mr. Nagaraj? Do we have him, or do we have anybody else? Any other speaker? Okay, we will get to, if I've missed somebody, we'll get to them. Now I'd like to, you know, invite Mr. M.B. Jairam. Yes, he's the Chief Emeritus and Mentor, PRCI. Sir, your few words for this evening. Jairam, sir?
Yeah, I'm here. good evening. It's a mind-boggling a wonderful webinar. I must thank Lata and her team doing a wonderful job. And thank you so much, all the speakers. It was an excellent job, Pushkarji. I thank you also for taking your precious time and be with us throughout the webinar. And thanks to all of you for the excellent really, we were missing all this kind of tourism. Normally, when I was in Power Corporation, every year I used to travel. I'll keep myself free for 15 to 20 days, and I used to go out. All memories come out now. It's all, you know, dream. Now I hope this COVID-19 will go away, and we will start moving towards tourism. We will support all tourism people who really good do a good job for us. The day will definitely come. Maybe we may have to wait for next few months. Then the same good old tourism days will continue further with a better facilities, etc., etc. I thank everyone for being with us today, and we have many more webinars to come in excellent topics. I request all of you to kindly join us for our other webinars. So try to reach all our PR members across the country. And thank you so much for allowing me to speak for a few minutes. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jairam sir, for your kind words. Also, I'd like to request our chief guest for this webinar, Mr. Kumar Pushkar, IFS officer. Sir, your one word or a sentence at the max about this international webinar today, sir. We're really happy to hear you. Do we have him, Mr. Kumar? Okay. I think
very nice.
Is that Mr. Kumar?
He's seen there in the list.
Yes. He's seen there. Mr. Kumar, are you around? Mr. Kumar Pushkar?
Nikhil, you ask. Yes. Nagraj is there, from Singapore.
Okay. Mr. Nagraj, go ahead. Your
was very informative, very well hosted. Thanks a lot for Dr. Lata and Nikhil. You did a wonderful job moderating it as well. Very good insights. Thanks a lot, everyone. Wonderful.
Thank you so much for that. Do we have Mr. Kumar as well, or are we able to connect to him?
No, Nikhil,
you can
go ahead.
Okay. May I now invite Mrs. Geeta Shankar, YCC National Head, to say a few words.
Hi, everybody, and thank you for the virtual uninterrupted tour we all experienced. Now the inner traveler instinct has been aroused again, and we in PRCI, just as how Mr. Jairam had said, we are just waiting to step out of our panic zone and tour and travel joyously again for all our webinars. Webinars definitely would end, and we are going to have live shows, and we're just waiting for that day. Okay, awesome program. I really have to thank each one of you for the wonderful program that has been hosted today. Chief guest, Mr. Kumar Pushkar, Managing Director, Karnataka State Tourism Development Corporation, Government of Karnataka. Thank you very much for being with us today. Rajan Sehgal, Chairman, Skills and Education Travel Agents Association of India. And also he's our Chairman, Public Relations Council of India, Delhi chapter. Thank you so much, Rajan. And Dr. Devika Menon from Kerala, Director, Princey World Travel Private Limited, Kerala. Awesome, ma'am. Thank you so much. We felt as if we were in Kerala. And Nirmal De Silva, MD, Destination Sri Lanka. In fact, we had visited Sri Lanka once, and then I think you should host again a tour where all of us are going to come there, Mr. Nirmal De Silva. And Lakshmi Sharath, travel blogger, awesome, ma'am. Thank you so much. Mr. Ankan Ganguly, ex-director, My Tirth India. I think our pilgrimage journey is all awaited, and you have to get us through all the...
Geeta, ma'am, I'm sorry to interrupt, but can I call two more people before you actually do the formal vote of thanks? Because I would like you to do the vote of thanks right after this. So, can I have two more people to talk about today's webinar and then come back to you again quickly for the vote of thanks? Is that okay?
Yeah. So I've left with Ankan Ganguly now. Okay.
Great. Yes. Or you can mention his name and thank him, and then we'll do the overall vote of thanks right now.
Yes. And then Dil Bahadur Karki, a Managing Director, Nepal Memorable Tours Private Limited. So we've already visited Nepal, and once more we would be there. We want us to be your host. Okay. Now we go on. Nikhil,
I will come back to you, Geeta ma'am, a little bit. Okay. I want to invite Mr. Jayaprakash Rao, South Zonal Head, PRCI, to say a few words about today's international webinar. Mr. Jayaprakash Rao, please. Sir, are you here?
I think he's there. Is he? Mr. Jayaprakash Rao? Sir, are you here? Okay, while we get him, can I have Mr. Ravindran, Governing Council, PRCI, to say a few words? Mr. Ravindran? Do we have him, Lata ma'am?
No, I don't think so. You please invite Ramendra, Rourkela Chairperson. Please.
Ramendra, Rourkela Chairperson, are you here?
Hi. It was an amazing, awesome session. I was engaged throughout. So many lovely, lovely insights. And Nikhil, as always, you were wonderful. You will end up giving Amitabh Bachchan a complex.
Thank you so much. I'll take that as a compliment. Thank you. Lata ma'am, do we...
Sundaram sir is there. Please invite Sundaram.
Yeah.
Sundaram sir, are you here?
It is very good, well conducted. Nice to listen than to talk. That was my thing. Lata, Nikhil, everybody conducted very well. So I want to be more intelligent than by listening to you all and adopting this. Very nice, well conducted. I very enjoyed the whole session. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Sundaram.
Mr. Frederick Michael, sir.
Mr. Frederick Michael.
Yeah, it was very good, Lata ma'am. The overall thing after this pandemic, it was such a refreshing webinar, especially tourism. You've literally taken a virtual tour around India, various places. All the speakers were excellent. It revived our memories and it was really good. Thanks again, once again, to Bangalore chapter and even the moderator. You've done an excellent job. Again, compliments to you. And I also thank Jairam sir and all the dignitaries present. It was an excellent webinar. Thank you all and best wishes from Hyderabad PRCI chapter. Sundaram Pillai is there. Sundaram Pillai.
Pillai, no, elder one. Sundaram is also there.
Jairam. Both, sir. Both.
Sundaram, I already spoken. Yeah.
Sundaram Pillai, sir.
Yeah. In a nutshell, a very lovely and lively presentation. I really enjoyed it from the beginning. Excellent. I wish that this continues in future also. Thank you.
Nitin Sharma from Jaipur. Nitin Sharma from Jaipur. Nitin he Sharma. Would like to speak. Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir. Thanks, everyone. And Nikhil, you did a wonderful job. And one more compliment to you. You look like a Bollywood star, Arshad Varsi.
Ah, yes. I have heard that before. Thank you. I'll take that as a compliment again.
I say belong to Jaipur and Jaipur has been known for, you know, one of the best destinations in the world in terms of tourism. So we are facing a lot of, you know, less of footfall. But hope we will come back and we'll spread the positivity. Thanks to all. Thank you very much.
Absolutely. Thank you for your few words. Yeah. Thank you.
Amit Srivastava and Sudhir Sopti.
Sudhir Sopti.
Yes. Join secretary, please.
Sudhir?
Sudhir Sopti, sir, from Delhi.
Hello, everyone. I just would like to conclude with saying that this was just fantastic, very well organized, and a very appropriate topic chosen, tourism, which is definitely need of the hour to be discussed and to be explored. We had very good insights from all the speakers and under the leadership of Mr. Jairam, all of you have done a very good job. Our compliments, and we look forward to many more similar webinars to come. Thank you very much once again.
Amish Srivastavji.
Amish Srivastavji, you there?
We have Mr. Kaul and we have Ashok Kumar Panda also, Lata. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Kaul, please, are you there?
Yes, Kaul, good sir? Evening to all. Good evening to all. Yes, Mr. Nikhil, yes, you were conducted nicely, especially you holding the mobile and we could hear Mr. Ajana's so many lines on the tourism. So it was wonderful. Thank you, sir. Session, I can say webinar was conducted excellently by our PRCI Bangalore chapter, and that all the speakers gave great insights to us in this pandemic, how to go ahead. So I think it's a very much knowledgeable session was there to understand what is going to happen in future and what the phase we are passing through. I wish such ideas have really brightened our hopes for the future tourism, and to be whatever we are afraid of going out. So it has given a hope that it is going to shortly be over and the life will turn back to the normalcy. And I thank to all of you for conducting this session, webinar. Congratulations to all the team members. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your words, sir. Thank you so much.
Ashok Pandaji. Ashok Pandaji.
Ashok Pandaji, you there?
I think he's not there.
He's not there. I don't see the screen.
Yes.
So Lata ma'am, we can go ahead and go ahead with a vote of thanks for the evening. All right. I'd like to invite Mrs. Geeta Shankar, whom I interrupted the other time. Once again, apologies for that, because I had to take the feedback from a lot of people. So please go ahead, ma'am, for the vote of thanks.
No issues. I think I completed almost a 3/4, thanking our chief guests and the speakers.
Yes.
And in fact, I wanted to thank the rest of the people who are here. But then since they've already spoken, I'm not going to take much time. Anyway, now coming on to our local chapter, Lata, Dr. T.S. Lata, Bangalore chapter chairperson, did a wonderful job. You've organized it extremely well, and then attention to details is something which you have looked into, coordinating everything, bringing in a lot of speakers nationally and internationally. Excellent work, chairperson, Bangalore chapter, and congratulations to your team too. And, you know, we had around 98 numbers audience who had zoomed in. And apart from that, almost from FB, we had around 320 numbers, if I'm not mistaken. They've logged in for this webinar. It's awesome. So, in fact, thank you so much to all the audience. You are the architect of our success, our webinar success. Thank you so much. And, of course, thank you so much, Mr. M.B. Jairam, Chairman Emeritus, for your undwindling support, I would say. And Dr. T. Vinay Kumar, thank you so much. He's our national chairperson. Jai Prakash Rao, South Zone Chairman, and who's not here at the moment, and Ravindran, and all our chapter chairmen, zonal heads, our PR CI brethren, ladies and gentlemen. And now coming on to the technical support by Mr. Saurabh Jairam and Rutuparna. Thanks a lot. Thank you so much. And Nikhil, wonderful job. Good to see you again, man. Thank you so much. You did a wonderful job. So
thank
we
you,
miss
thank
you so much. And we like your new hairstyle and with a lot of a black tinge on your beard. Okay. Anyway, you did
it's
a great
to be young.
Yeah. All right. Thanks a lot. Thanks, Bangalore team. And thank you, Ashish Tayal. And thank you, Pallavi.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you so much.
All right. So thank you, Mrs. Geeta Shankar, for the word of thanks. Lata ma'am, with your permission, I'd like to end this international webinar today on, you know, World Tourism Day.
Yes,
so
I want to say one word of thanks to Ajit, new EC member, Ajit Toragal, Shiv Prakash, okay. Guru Raj. They are the new EC members, Manjula, and our team, Renuka Nanda, Pallavi, and most importantly, our Nikhil Kumar. He's our heart of the show. Thank you so much, Nikhil. Thank
Beeta,
you.
Beeta, and Chaya also there.
Chaya. Ramkrishna, sir.
Yes.
Whoever.
And from Kolkata, there are many people from Kolkata chapter. For them also, I salute Kerala team. Kerala team. And Hyderabad team, there are many people from all over the country.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much.
We had TVS Narayan, we had Nivedita Lokesh, we have Ramana Kumar, Lehri Mukherjee from Kolkata.
Yes. Right. Thank you so much. In fact, I must now take just that, you know, 10-20 seconds to thank first Bangalore chairperson Dr. Lata, who's actually had that confidence in me to host the webinar, and also I must thank my mentor, who's Mr. Jairam, for that unconditional belief in me. It's been quite a few number of years, so thank you, Jairam sir, and also the entire team of PRCI Bangalore, also Mrs. Geeta Shankar. I have to thank the entire team at PRCI for making me do this, hosting this webinar, or rather, being the moderator for it. So heartful thanks. And Lata ma'am, with your permission, we're gonna end the webinar today.
Please.
Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you to the audience.
Thank you to everyone.
Thank you,
everyone. Thank you.
Bye bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Bye bye.